Hello and welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent episode and guest for you, but before I go ahead, make sure you subscribe to the channel. We have magnificent content there. Check out the previous videos and also acknowledge our partners. And this week we are actually focusing on telehealth adoption and have a magnificent guest for you, Professor Joseph Charles Kvedar. He is a senior advisor of the Massachusetts General Hospital Center for Innovation in Digital Healthcare. He's also a professor of dermatology at Harvard Medical School and also the board chair at the American Telemedicine Association. He's an author and also a thought leader in connected health. Professor Joseph, how are you?
I'm well. Thank you so much for having me on your program.
No, it's brilliant. We were saying before the recording, but I've been following your magnificent work and the things that you're doing for the industry. It's fantastic.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, it's an uphill battle every day, but we're excited to see progress.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you so much for accepting the invite and for being here. I know you are busy, and by those accolades, everyone knows that you are very busy and very active. So, fantastic. I'm going to go straight to the questions. Is that okay?
Sure, let's do it.
Brilliant. And the first question that I have for you is, in your day-to-day activity, what do you encounter as main challenges in digital healthcare innovation?
Well, it's a great question. I think you could answer it in two different ways. I think my bias is that I'm a healthcare provider. I'm a physician by training. I still see patients. So I tend to think from that lens. And from that lens, there's just tremendous inertia. And it really goes into two reasons for it, I believe, that are just fundamental to, for any innovation, but certainly digital is right up there. The first is that we as healthcare providers are bound to treat our patients in a way that doesn't harm them, right? We, above all, do no harm. And so we're very cautious about anything new. Digital health is fundamentally about changing the relationship between the doctor and the patient. And so that's people get freaked out over that. They get worried about it. So that's one. I think the other, at least in the U.S., I think in most developed countries, there's a strong just financial engine that keeps us going back to the same old way we always did it, because there's a lot of people out there that make a living on that. And so one person said to me once, and I often quote this, that any dollar in healthcare saved is a dollar of someone's income lost. And so that trend of that tension between saving money and someone else losing is a big thing, because the reason I say that in this context is I think fundamentally our digital health innovations are going to be more efficient and therefore save money in the long run. So it's really those two things. There are, of course, many others. There's always, you know, talk about how startups can fail or succeed and the like. But to me, those are two big drags on innovation.
Oh, brilliant. That's really a magnificent point and insight there, because it's a funny dynamic, isn't it? A conflict of interest, making the money, and someone else is losing, and we don't want any losses, but it's just the way the industry works, unfortunately, for innovation. Fantastic. Thank you. Moving on to the second question, and the question is, today we are seeing a rise in telehealth, and we focus in here on telemedicine and telehealth adoption. What needs to be in place to further implement telehealth adoption?
Well, so I come from this one also. Again, my caveat is it's a U.S. perspective for the most part, although I try to keep a global perspective. It's, I think, very hard for healthcare delivery because each country is a little bit different. At least in the U.S., we need long-term clarity around how our doctors and hospitals are going to get paid for this activity. Right now we're in the midst of the public health emergency. And so we're getting paid to do this work. And it's, as you say, growing in adoption. The good news, patients are quite pleased. They want to see more of this way of healthcare delivery. It's what I call two channel now, that I don't think we're going to go back to one channel where the only solution is come to the office. So that's all very positive. But for healthcare providers to make big investments on the future, whether it be the technology platform or rearranging how they triage patients into the office or how they even use physical space, these are big, when you think about it, these are big deal decisions. It's not unlike the bookstores when Amazon came in, or the travel agents when the online travel providers came in. Those are the fundamental challenges we're dealing with. And so for us to make those long-term bets on the future, we need to see a clear path to reimbursement. In the U.S., it's an interesting business, because although we spend a lot of money on healthcare, and we could digress on how much of it's wasted, healthcare hospitals and most healthcare providers are on small margins. They're 2, 3, 4% most of the time profit margins, because they're nonprofits. So for them to go out on a limb and invest a lot of capital in a future that is uncertain, it's just very difficult. So to me, that's the big thing. If we could get clarity from both our government and the private payers on what the reimbursement future is, then I think things would fall into place to sustain this two-channel delivery system that I just referred to.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah, it's a great insight there. And also, as you know, the reimbursement is slowly coming to fruition. Also in Europe, now Germany adopted like a mixed reimbursement system, and in Europe is, I'm based in UK, I try to follow also a global perspective, as you know, it's very challenging because every country is different and you can't be an expert in 100 countries. But I try to keep an eye on things as well. And reimbursement is certainly very important to move the agenda forward, because we can cut the cost of healthcare, but also on the other hand is very challenging because the cost goes to public health or to someone else in this case. So
right.
It's always
the additive. Yeah. It has to be substitutive. And that's another theme here that we keep talking. When we talk to our payer colleagues here in the States, they'll say that to us, is that you can't just add a whole bunch of service delivery that adds delivery and cost. We have to be able to substitute some face-to-face care if we're going to use virtual, and we're working on that, but that's a challenge as well.
Yeah, brilliant. And you mentioned at the beginning of your answer that one complements the other, isn't it? Because for some people, or for one reason or another, or they don't have access to digital, or they don't like to use digital solutions, the face-to-face and the traditional delivery is still very strong, because people are used to do things in a certain way. So it takes time to kind of implement and make a major change. Thank you so much. Right, moving on to the third and last question is, what are your predictions for telehealth and digital health?
Well, I'm smiling because I think about it. I'm dating myself, but Johnny Carson used to put a turban on and do Carnac the Great. So it is a challenge. As I said, there's so many moving parts right now, but it's very, one thing that's very clear is that, as I said earlier, patients really want to do more of this kind of care delivery in general. Yes, there's some people who prefer to come in the office, and I have this dialogue going with my patients all the time. And if they prefer to come in, please, oh, by all means, come on in. Right now, anyway, we're not on lockdown, thankfully, in the U.S., or at least the Northeast. So there's that dynamic of patient preference. There's also a lot of efficiency gain for some simple transactions where we just say, yeah, sure, go on the patient portal, do X, Y, and Z, and we can get it done quickly. And that's of value as well. So we know that generally when we offer multiple kinds of service delivery to our patients, shock upon shock, they like the efficient thing. They like the easy thing. They like the convenient thing. So I don't think we're going to see that go away. And now that it's out there, one of the other dynamics that I worry about is that our health plans will start providing these services, or virtual first. That's another really big trend in the US, and we'll see fragmented care. So one prediction is that, that we'll have these virtual first providers coming into the market. They already are. And that there's going to be a lot of tension between who owns primary care and the fragmentation of care around our patients. Another thing is more home testing, because home testing, as we've seen with COVID, is a godsend. It can really improve your virtual experience with your doctor if you have those results. Something you're, I know, an expert on, but home technology, wearables, et cetera, more and more of that going on. Here in the U.S., we now have new reimbursement systems for remote patient monitoring, remote therapeutic monitoring using apps and devices. So that's really taking off, as it should. That's a true way of providing more efficient care. And I like to just throw in one more, which is digital biomarkers is something I'm very interested in. These are software tools that live on your mobile device and track something about you. Oftentimes it is voice, at least in the current iteration. One company that I'm advising, for instance, out of Australia, a company called ResApp Health, their tools can detect sleep apnea and respiratory illness without a physical exam. And so again, that's a breakthrough for virtual care. If you can picture having a cough, dialing up your doctor virtually, and your doctor just says, cough into your phone, and we don't need to listen to your lungs. That's pretty impressive, and we'll see more and more of that. There's a lot of that in the behavioral health world as well, that predicting things like depression and so forth. So those are some predictors that I see coming into the market in the next months to years.
Oh, brilliant. Thank you so much for that. And you mentioned that voice, digital biomarkers by voice. I also know a company in Israel doing great work globally. And that's truly groundbreaking, as you mentioned, because it's non-invasive, it's not a traditional way of doing, it's like providing the data and a bit of a predictive insight into many types of disease. And you mentioned wearables. You know, I'm an advocate and a fan of wearables. The wearables expert, and wearables will certainly play a very crucial part in the healthcare delivery of the future. And technology is really taking off. This is an interesting conversation. Now we could pick up another subject and talk for a couple of hours on that specific question. But Joe, I want to thank you for your time. I'm a fan, as I said at the beginning of the recording. I follow your work. You've been doing great things. I appreciate that you are here with us today to share your magnificent expertise. So,
well, thank you, João, and it's a pleasure to be part of your program. And let's plan on chatting again in the near future.
Sure. Before I round up, it's not really a question as such. I round up all my episodes with a thing called 1 minute of fame, that you can mention anything, a company or work, a personal achievement, family, anything whatsoever. So before I round up to our viewers and listeners, over to you, Joe, 1 minute of fame.
Well, I would say probably some of the startups I'm working with right now. So there's one called Chronisense, which is a wrist-worn blood pressure monitor. Again, it's an Israeli company. And another one called Switch out of Israel, it happens. I'm very fond of their work on behavioral change through artificial intelligence. So those are a couple of examples.
Brilliant. Fantastic. What a great way to finish with some magnificent innovation. I'm going to round up now. Joe, thank you so much again.
Thank you.
To all our viewers and the listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel and share this magnificent content with your communities in healthcare. And also, I'm going to post Joe's LinkedIn and Twitter in here. Connect with him, follow his work, ask him questions, a true expert about what's going on in US, outside the US, the innovations that you hear about in Israel and these digital health connections. And I look forward to seeing you all next week.